Lily's mom said that she started to hang out with a experimenting with the marijuana, and Lily began to get more and more into the party scene in our city. She began staying out all night, and it was around this time that Lily was diagnosed with depression by a school psychologist. Around her 16th birthday, Lily dropped out of school and began experimenting with different drugs like ecstasy and ketamine. She would stay out all night, sleep in parks, sleep on the street. And her mother would frantically search for her night after night. But Lily would go home now and then. She would kind of pass out for a few days, sober up, and then disappear again. It was during this time period that Lily met Kelly Ray Starling. And these two girls were just joined at the hip. They lived on the streets together, in cars, in vacant houses, while they were on these drug benders. Kelly said, quote, "We enjoyed just being out in the streets, doing whatever we wanted to." Lily was the closest girlfriend I ever had. At one point, me and her were living inside a Toyota. We had a pet bunny, too. So, Lily's mom was really struggling with our daughter's high-risk behaviors. At this time, she worried every day that our daughter would just never come home. And sadly, that would end up being the case. Lucely said, quote, "It was very tough for me. I was a nervous wreck. I couldn't concentrate on my business." In 2003, when Lily was 20 years old, she met a man named David Lamiso, who was really struggling with a heroin addiction at the time. Relationship was rocky, and they both really enabled each other in their addictions. Lily became more and more dependent on drugs, and by 2004, the two of them had kind of graduated to crack cocaine. The effects on Lily were clearly visible. According to her mother, she was just becoming angrier and angrier. And during this time, her mother said Lily was diagnosed with schizophrenia. She said, quote, she was paranoid and having hallucinations. David and Lily moved in together, and her mother knew things had gotten really bad when she didn't see or hear from Lily for an entire month. Her mom was devastated and super concerned with Lily's disappearance, and she began looking for her anywhere she thought Lily may be spending time. When she finally found her one morning at a bus stop, she said she knew right away her daughter was high on heroin. She said she looked awful. Lily steadily became angry. and her entire perspective changed. She said she was making an effort to do the right things and set herself up in a positive way. In 2007, Lily gave birth to a little boy she named stayed there until April 29th, but she was kicked out history of attempted suicide and was a diagnosed schizophrenic who suffered from depression. Police began looking for Lily right away, but given her past lifestyle of sleeping on the streets and crashing in abandoned homes, they knew they would have their work cut out for them trying to locate her. Plus, at this point, there were no signs of foul play, so Lily's disappearance really didn't take top priority. According to Christian, Lily had been upset and had stormed out, so there was also a possibility that she just didn't want to be found. But weeks turned into months, and Lily never popped back up, and police had very little to go by. And from some news sources that I read while researching this case, it does seem like police had kind of written Lily off as a missing drug addict, and they kind of turned their efforts into solving other cases. Many people still believe that Christian knows more about what happened to Lily than he is letting on. But Christian has clapped back, saying, quote, "I am only guilty of loving that girl. To have someone blatantly accuse me of harming her is horrible." Now, Christian did leave town after Lily went missing, so he actually owned his condo and then another property, a three-bedroom house off 101st Avenue. Shortly before he left town, he told a neighbor that he was just going to let both properties foreclose. He told this neighbor that both places had such bad memories, and he just didn't want them anymore. Now, I couldn't find a ton of information about Christian, but I know he graduated from Bishop O'Reilly High School in Kingston, Pennsylvania, in 1992. He enlisted with the Marines and then spent the next 9 years becoming an expert computer system engineer and rifleman. He moved to Miami in 2001 when he was hired as the technology director for a local office of a global consulting firm. That same year, according to the Miami-Dade Criminal Court files, he was arrested on a battery charge. The case was dismissed, and there are no other details available. Christian's descent into drugs began just as his career was taking off. Just a year earlier, he had purchased the house at 16030 Southwest 101st Avenue for $168,000, and then in 2005 he bought his Dayland condo for $150,000. He rode around in a 2006 black Cadillac Escalade and owned a $3,000 motorcycle. According to the Miami Times, so he seemed to just be peaking in his career when his drug addiction took hold. That's kind of all I could find about him. And there really hasn't been much in Lily's case since. According to the Miami Times, more than 40,000 unidentified bodies are reported across the nation each year. And that's according to the Federal Law Enforcement records. And there are more than 100,000 reports senior citizens, and the good weather that allows people to be outside often is a particular mecca for missing persons, missing elderly persons. The Miami-Dade County Police Department receives a monthly average of 400 to 600 people who have gone missing, according to Captain Jana Heller, head of the Domestic Crimes Bureau. In 2007, 5,000 people were reported missing, at least temporarily, in the unincorporated Miami-Dade. And this year to date, there are 3,500 active missing persons cases. So this particular area has an incredibly high volume of people who go missing. The police captain went on to say, quote, "We are talking about runaways to elderly folks who walk away from nursing homes. And with adults, they can go missing on purpose too. 90% of their missing persons cases are closed within a year." So Lily's friends and family members have understandably been incredibly frustrated with the lack of movement and the lack of coverage that Lily's case has gotten. Her friend Janet Forte created a MySpace page, as well as a group and causes page where people can join and read about Lily's disappearance. She also posted photos of Lily on Flickr and mymilkgarden.org, which is a site that allows people to post information and pictures of missing loved ones. And then there's a blog called Justice in Miami, blogspot.com, and every day Janet updates it. Often she's criticizing the police department's handling of the investigation, but she's really made it like her life's mission to find out what happened to her friend. On one blog post she wrote, quote, "Chances are you've probably never met Lily, but if you did, you would understand why we are so determined to find her. Lily was a girl of peace, a young mother who loved her baby boy very much. She was a humble person and a good friend who touched everyone she met with her beautiful smile. She had the energy of a small child. She loved music, and although she loved rock, oldies were secretly her favorite songs. She loved to read and write in journals, but refused to learn computers. She was a very simple girl who shopped at vintage stores and hardly ever wore makeup. The term Earth Girl comes to mind when I think of her. And a pixie as well. People would often confuse her as a teenager because she looked so damn young. Lily was tough still, both emotionally and physically. Once she fell off a second-story building at the University of Miami campus. She went to the hospital and walked out, took the brace off, and just kept going because she had to be at work the next day. When she was pregnant with her son, she glowed. It was the most amazing time in her life and the loveliest I have ever seen her. Her skin looked golden olive and her almond-shaped eyes glistened. I could see life in her. She was truly happy and hopeful and looking forward to the birth of her son. Unfortunately, this is kind of all we mother has been raising her son, Paulden. Lily was a Hispanic female. She had brown hair and brown eyes. She had a scar on her left hand and a scar below her left knee, a C-section scar on her lower abdomen, freckles on her shoulder and face, and musical notes tattooed on her back. Her nickname is Lily, and many accounts refer to her by that name, but she may also use the alias names Ashley Green or Amber Hall. Her ears are pierced. She had previously broken her right wrist and her back in that fall. If you have any information about the disappearance of Lily, please contact the Miami-Dade Police Department at 305-418-7200. I just want to quickly cite my sources for this video. I got information from Defrosting Cold Cases. They had an article titled Lucille Aramburo, published on February 7th, 2010. The Miami New Times had an article by Francisco Alvarado, published December 11th, 2008, titled Missing Person, Lily Aramburo. And then another Miami New Times article, also written by Francisco Alvarado, titled Police Suspect Missing Mom Lily Aramburo Might Have Been Killed, published January of 2011. Thank you guys so much for joining me for another video. Remember to check out the link down below to shop the Ana Luisa Mother's Day sale. And if you're watching this video after Mother's Day, you can save 20% by using code